Okay, hi everybody, and welcome to this presentation on Python for developing a real-time automated trading platform. I'm glad to see so many of you and so many familiar faces, so I hope I won't let you down. first of all, a little bit about us. This project has been developed in Open Sistemas, and in particular in the research and development division, which is led by Fernando Moreira. And also, Guillermo Alonso is now part of this development team and is here today among the audience. A little bit about me as well. My name is Miguel Sánchez de León. I'm an industrial engineer with backgrounds in electronics, automatic control. I feel passion for programming, data analysis, and machine learning. I met Python about 2 years ago, which is exactly when I started working with Open Sistemas. And since then, I've been gradually falling in love with this programming language, which I currently use on a daily basis. What's the motivation behind this project? If you go on the internet and search for currently available platforms for real-time automated trading, you might find things like TradeStation, MetaTrader, NinjaTrader, and in fact, many, many others, each of them with their own little differences. But unfortunately, they all share some caveats. So for example, they are all proprietary, and they are very heavily desktop-oriented, which means that many of them don't even run if you don't have a desktop environment. Do they provide Linux support? Well, the answer is no. And can I use Python, which is the most important question? Can you use Python to create my strategies, my trading strategies? And the answer here is a big no. And that's really, really sad. So we didn't want that. What we wanted? We wanted to have control over our own tool. So we needed to have the source code to be able to modify it at will. We wanted it to have an optional graphical user interface. And we wanted it to be multi-platform, so it could be run on Linux, but on Windows and any other, at least, major platforms. And we wanted it to be programmed in Python, of course, because we love this programming language. So is this possible? That's the question. Dramatic pause. The answer is yes. And we call it OS Markets. OS Markets is a broker-independent platform for real-time automated trading. With broker independent, what do I mean? I mean that it should be able to work with any broker available out there, as long as, of course, the broker provides us with a convenient API to interact with. It is implemented over OS Brain. OS Brain is a multi-agent architecture. If you're interested in this architecture, there will be later another talk just about this tool, so please come and join us. And it is designed for real-time automated trading, and that means that it must be fast and it must be robust, okay? So this is an overview of an example of an architecture implemented with OS Markets. As we can see, the input of this system, which is on the left, is the raw market data, right? The data that our broker provides. Then we feed this data to our system, and the output is going back to the broker as buy or sell orders, right? So we'll go, we can see a couple of circles in there, and those are the agents in this multi-agent system or architecture. And the arrows in between them represent the message passing. These agents are completely independent, all right, and they communicate with each other using message passing to avoid concurrency. So we'll start by the one which is on the left, which is called the feeder, because each of those agents plays a different role, okay? They are specialized. What's the feeder? The feeder is an agent which is broker dependent, all right, and it's designed to get market data from the brokers and then transform it and then send it to our own system. It is a kind of multi-threaded agent, and we'll see later what that means. But I think it is sufficient to know that a feeder usually have to deal with different, perhaps, streams of data and at the same time handling common requests. For example, getting historical data from the broker. Going back to the overview, just on the right of feeder, there's another agent called router. And this agent is designed to be, this time, a broker-independent provider, right? All the feeders get data from different brokers. They make kind of a translation of this data and then send it to the router. The router stores this data and then distributes it among the rest of the agents in the system. It is also useful for updating and resample data. That means that usually, or many times, there's an agent that requests some kind of data that you currently don't have, but it is able to resample and perhaps generate a different time period data for the agent that requested it. What's the market data that we are usually working with? Usually, it is the tick data, which is simply the bid and ask prices at a current time step. A bar is usually the combination of the open, high, low, and close price values during a time span, in this case. And then a bar series is simply a series of bars. So how do we implement the bar series? Because if you may have noticed that these series are updated in real time. So even though we use NumPy behind the scenes, right, we don't want to do full memory copies on each update. So when a new bar arrives, or when we create a new bar with tick data, we don't want to copy all the memory each time. So instead, we use a base array, which is something that NumPy already implements, and we simply change the view. So we update the base, and then we change the view so that we have a different bar series. And this way, we avoid most of the full memory copies on each update. Going back to the overview, at the right of router, we have the brain, which is the most common agent in the system. And brain is able to subscribe to router in order to receive updates and also to subscribe to other agents, because agents are meant to run the algorithm. So they usually process the incoming data, they make some kind of transformation, and perhaps they start publishing this information to other agents that might be interested in it in the system. And they are also able to send orders, of course, because if these agents run the algorithms, they are also the ones in charge of deciding when we should buy or when we should sell. It is important to remember that this is written in Python, and that means that Python has a really great ecosystem for data analysis and statistics, so we can make use of, I don't know, Theano, of NumPy, and Numba, any other package available out there. So at the end, you can do anything which you can do with Python, which is usually just anything. So it's great. This is also very interesting because with this architecture, we can create kind of an abstraction, a hierarchy, in which in the lowest level, we'll have those brains that work with the raw market data. And then as we go up in the layers, we start working with agents that have as input, a transformation of data, which is usually some kind of abstraction, until we start having the highest abstraction level, which is something closer to how a real human trader works. So this way, it is easier to implement what would be normally complex algorithms for trading. Going back to the overview, the last agent that we can see here is the one on the right, which is the trader. And the trader is the one that handles the orders that come from the brains, and it's also another multi-threaded agent. It's also, of course, broker dependent, because you have to implement a different trader in order to communicate to different brokers available out there. As an example, just to make it clear, imagine that we had this system without the blue brain, and at some point we spawn a new brain, because we can do that, and this brain starts subscribing or requesting some data to router. Router may not have it available, so it's sends the request back to feeder, and the feeder asks this data from the broker, it gets it, and sends it back to router and back to the brain. The brain gets this data, and then starts receiving real-time updates from router, perhaps tick data, and then it also starts publishing information, in this case to another brain, and also sending orders to a trader. So it is completely flexible. There are other agents that we haven't mentioned, but just for you to know, we of course have a logger agent to log all kind of messages or errors that may occur, an informer agent, an overmind, which is kind of an agent that can control the state of all the agents in the system that are currently running. I said that we also developed a graphical user interface. So this graphical interface is meant to be used for real-time market data visualization, and also real-time indicators visualization. These indicators, for those of you who don't know what are just simply mathematical transformations of the raw market data or the original data that helps us interpret what the markets are doing. It is integrated with OS markets, and we'll see later how that works. So how did we do this? We used Qt, or Qt, however you want to pronounce it, because of its great portability and because it's probably the most widely used framework available out there. Okay, I know that some use GTK. That's perfectly fine. We just choose Qt. And it's LGPL, which is also very good. But for me, the most important part, it's PyQtGraph, which is, I think, not so well known package which is written in pure Python, and it's meant to be used for fast real-time display. And it's, it implements out of the box interaction with the graphs that it can generate. So you can zoom in or zoom out or pan your graph, and everything is implemented already in PyQtGraph. So if you want to do some kind of real-time visualization, you should have a look at this project. We can have here an overview of the graphical user interface. In the main window, we can have the agents that are running the system, for example, and we can open new tabs or new windows, multiple, so we can visualize different market data simultaneously. I'm sorry, I have to do that. Now, this is the chart window, okay, where we can display the market data. And so we can change, for example, the period. And this will translate into a request to router that will generate, if it doesn't have it already, new market data and send it back to the graphical user interface. And we are able also to pause the real-time updates in the graph. So we can freely move in the graph. We can zoom in, zoom out in one axis and two axis. And as I said, this is all done with PyQtGraph. So it was very simple to implement. And apart from that, we have an indicators window in which we can select new indicators that we can add to the chart. We can add them just below the market data, or we can add some indicators that are displayed on top of the market data. So in this case, we can add a simple moving average. And as you can see, we see this graph plotted on top of the chart. And then we can also change the period, all right, or the parameters of these indicators in real time. The graph is updated as well in real time. Of course, all the functionality, like zooming in, zooming out, and panning, still works pretty fine. But as I said, the most important thing is that this is just like a client and another agent in this multi-agent architecture. So each of those charts, each of those tabs or windows is just a different agent that subscribes to other routers or brains. So in fact, this indicator is not calculated in the graphical user interface, but rather spawns a new agent that calculates the indicator, okay, the data, and then subscribes to real-time update from this agent. So what is OS Brain? OS Brain is a general purpose multi-agent system. And we have developed this OS Markets architecture just on top of this tool, OS Brain. In a general purpose multi-agent system, agents are independent, and they communicate with each other using message passing, as I mentioned. And OS Brain, in particular, is kind of easy to configure and deploy as well. We'll see later how. So when we say that it is a general purpose multi-agent system, what do we mean? We mean that exactly. I mean, we not only use this for real-time trading, but for example, we use this to do some kind of portfolio analysis and optimization. We have a set of backtests, and then we send them to pools of workers distributed in many different systems, and each of them takes a reduced sample of those backtests and performs some portfolio optimization, some correlation analysis, and then that acts like a filter for repeating this step in kind of multiple layers until we get to a final portfolio that we like. So this way, we won't be able to get the best portfolio among all the strategies, but at least it is computationally acceptable, and we get a good portfolio. Note that new agents or new machines can be spawned at any time, okay? So we can just turn off some machines or turn on new machines, and they will start receiving new jobs from the distributor or the dispatcher. We said also that the agents are completely independent, and how did we do this? Well, if you already know the GIL, I think you know the answer. If you don't know what the GIL is, better for you, because your life is much simpler and you live happier. So they communicate with each other using message passing, and what did we use for message passing? We used ZeroMQ, and if you are interested to know why, we will explain that better in the next presentation. But for now, I'll say just that ZeroMQ is very cool. So in fact, if you don't have a project that needs it, you should create one, because you'll have fun. So a basic agent, what it is? For now, we know that this is a system process, so it's independent. It implements methods for easy binding and connecting with different patterns. And it also activates on incoming message. Normally, an agent is kind of passive, so it waits for new updates that comes from another brain in the system. Multithreading may be used, but we will not stop there. Configuration, we said that it was easy to configure and deploy these kind of systems, and how do we do this? Because we have many different agents, and agents can have many different sockets, communicating with many other agents using many different patterns for communication. So that's kind of difficult if you want to, for example, configure everything in a file, all the directions or all the sockets. So in fact, most of the time, just assigning a random address is much simpler. So if only we could, that's an idea, like having a name server where the agents could register, or have an overmind, something that would know the addresses of all the agents. And that's where Pyro 4 comes in. Pyro 4 is another great tool and not very well known, unfortunately. Pyro comes from Python Remote Objects. And this library, this module, allows us to treat remote objects as local. How is it done? Well, Pyro spawns a server, okay, a remote server, that is serving an object, Python object. And then you can use a proxy, which is a variable that you use locally in your machine. And then this proxy allows you to execute methods as if they were the methods of the object that is running remotely. So when you execute a method, this method gets serialized to the server. The Pyro server executes this code remotely in the agent, and then it returns back to you the result, if that is the case. And apart from that, it already has a name server implementation, so it's a win-win decision. So a real agent, now we know what it is. It is a system process, and this process runs a Pyro multiplexed server, and the server serves the actual agent object, okay, this Python object. And, well, main thread, which is the one, is the one that runs the main loop, because as I said, usually an agent is just waiting for incoming messages, so it's just polling on all the different input socket that it has. Okay, that may vary, but usually that is the case. So as a conclusion, Python was great for creating a general purpose multi-agent system, and the agents were independent thanks to the use of processes, because unfortunately with the chill and the most famous implementations of Python, that is not possible using threads. And message passing is implemented with ZeroMQ, and the deployment is very easy, and the configuration as well using Pyro 4. So here are some code examples. This is an example of a code for OS Brain. If you stay here for the next talk, we'll see a lot of examples. But in this case, as you can see, we're just spawning a random name server. And then here we run two agents, Alice and Bob. And we get in here the proxies that I mentioned earlier. So we can execute the methods of the remote object. So locally, although this is all just a script which is run in the same machine, but theoretically you can run this in a remote machine and you can execute from the proxy this method bind and create a socket using a push communication pattern. You assign an alias as well and then you connect from the receiver. And basically this example just is a hello world from, you know, from Alice to Bob. Alice will start sending hello world messages to Bob. This is an example of how the code looks like in the real-time automated trading platform that we implemented over OS Brain. So in this case, for example, we're just inheriting from the class Brain, because that's a basic class, and we are creating a new method or implementing a method on new bar, which is executed each time a new bar comes in the Brain. And it's a very stupid algorithm that you should not use, of course, with trading money. And basically, it's the close price right now is higher than before we buy, otherwise we sell, for example. And then here is the deployment of the architecture, which is also, it's also very simple. We create, in this case, an Oanda architecture because we want to work with Oanda broker, which is one of the brokers available out there. We pass some parameters for like our account ID, our access token, etc. And then we start streaming some real-time data. In this case, we select just the euro-dollar pair because we are trading with Forex. And then we add this Brain. We have a method, and we add the Brain based on the class that we created here. Note that this architecture could be run in a remote server, and we could serialize this class. So you can create the class in your client in another machine, and then say to the server, OK, run this new Brain. And then you serialize all the code, and the code is executed remotely and created there. And then just this is the perhaps the most important part. When we tell this brain, we can access the brain or a proxy to this brain, like if we were using a dictionary in the system, and we select the alias example, because we created this brain called example. And when we tell the brain to subscribe, it will subscribe to router, of course. And then it will subscribe to real-time updates on euro-dollar pair based on 1 minute period. All right. And apart from that, it will request 100 bars, because maybe we need this for running our algorithm. OK, so as a final conclusion, Python have improved to be a great language for implementing a real-time automated trading platform. And that's it. One last thing, OS Brain has been recently released as open source. So if you want to have a look at this project, please do. You can find it on PyPy if you want to install it with pip. You can find it on GitHub. You can see the source code and then throw stones at me. And then you can find also some documentation and a tutorial in Read the Docs. If you liked this, please stay for the next presentation. Come here, and we will see a lot of samples and how this tool, OS Brain, works. So that's it. Here you can find our contact information. Those are links, and this presentation is uploaded to my profile in GitHub, so just download it if you want to get this information. And don't forget that we are hiring, so if you are interested not only in this, but you can have also a look at the company website in the What We Do section, and if you like anything that we do, please send us your CV. So that's it. Thank you very much for your attention. Any questions? Yeah? Pueden ser en castellano, ¿eh? Perfectamente.
una pregunta. A la hora de, por ejemplo, integrarlo en MetaTrader, ¿no puede generar ningún otro tipo de datos a la hora de ejecutar la operación?
A la hora de integrarlo con MetaTrader, ¿no puedes generar un tipo de...? Perdón. Creo que no te estoy entendiendo. ¿Puedes repetirlo otra vez? Ah, retardo, perdona, es lo que no estaba entendiendo. Disculpa, gracias. Si se crea algún retardo a la hora de interactuar, bueno, has dicho con MetaTrader, MetaTrader es una plataforma gráfica, pero te refieres a lo mejor con el broker, ¿no? Desde luego que hay un retardo, claro, es un retardo que tienes que tener en cuenta a la hora de realizar las operaciones. El cuello de botella que hay a la hora de conectarte con los brokers es importante. Es decir, todo depende también de la inversión que quieras realizar en la arquitectura, ¿no? En tus sistemas. La gente que gana mucho dinero, esto es proporcional al dinero que ganas, tienen también equipos muy, muy caros conectados con fibra óptica que va directa desde su ordenador hasta donde está la información, ¿no? Y muchas veces no pasan por brokers, sino que son ellos los brokers. Sí.
Claro, se incrementa ese procesado un poco más, ¿no?
Claro. Vale, la pregunta es si al añadir esta capa el sistema resulta más lento. Esto a lo mejor sí puede tener algún efecto perjudicial para el sistema. Todo depende también del time frame, ¿no? El periodo con el que estés trabajando. Es decir, esto no es un tema de high frequency trading, ¿no? Para eso hace falta, como digo, tener unos sistemas, ¿no? Unas arquitecturas que son muy, muy caras, de hardware, digo. Entonces, esto está diseñado pues, para trabajar en el orden pues, de los segundos, de los minutos, y para eso es más que suficiente, sí. O sea, el retardo que añade no es significativo. Aún así, desde luego, pues claro, es inevitable, ¿no? Desde que tú mandas la orden hasta que le llega al broker y hasta que el broker la ejecuta, luego, si le da la gana, pues pueden pasar varios milisegundos, efectivamente. Pero estaríamos hablando de milisegundos, ¿no? Pero a lo mejor decenas de milisegundos.
Claro.
Claro, hombre, medio plazo. Pues estamos hablando de minutos, ¿no? Nosotros lo utilizamos sobre todo operando con minutos. Es decir, abres una operación ahora y dentro de algunos minutos la cierras. Aún así es verdad que es importante, ¿eh? la latencia para la ejecución de la orden. Sobre todo porque los backtests los haces suponiendo que las entradas las haces en el momento preciso, ¿no? Tienes la información de los ticks y se supone que tú estás entrando en el momento exacto. Y luego en la realidad eso no ocurre. Pero cuando trabajas con periodos de minutos o incluso pues, de segundos, pero de varios segundos, ¿no? Por encima de un segundo y si puede ser por encima de 10, esto empieza a ser menos significativo. En todo caso también es peligroso operar con periodos muy, muy, muy pequeños, porque en ese momento también empiezas a dejar de confiar en los datos que te da el broker. Bueno. ¿Más preguntas? Sí. Los backtests que hacemos, sí. Lo que pasa es que esto no es una arquitectura de backtest. Nosotros separamos ese proceso. Hacemos los backtests con otras herramientas, que también son propias, y sí, 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 de hecho, bastante más rápido. Empezamos haciendo backtests con herramientas propietarias, como MetaTrader, y luego simplemente utilizando bibliotecas como Numpy y Pandas, y luego Numba también, que fue un descubrimiento maravilloso. Un just-in-time compiler, ¿no? que te permite trabajar además con arrays de NumPy, conseguimos alcanzar unos rendimientos muy, muy altos. También, eso sí, claro, afinando cosas que MetaTrader no puedo afinar, ¿no? O sea, a veces para ciertas estrategias puedes hacer algunos trucos para acelerar los backtests. Pero es separado, efectivamente. Tú con los backtests haces un análisis estadístico, histórico, haces walk forward, sacas tus estrategias, sacas tu portfolio y después, una vez tienes esa configuración, la ejecutas en tiempo real. Esto sería una plataforma para ejecutarlo en tiempo real, que es distinto. ¿Más preguntas? Sí.
La información que hemos estado viendo esos brokers, lo que tú realmente estabas ejecutando, ¿es algo que viene de... realmente, ¿quién le está enviando ese tipo de información?
¿Quién está enviando ese tipo de información? Claro, son los brokers, que son empresas, en realidad, que se dedican a esto, que es a proporcionarte los datos de mercado en tiempo real, efectivamente. No cualquiera tiene acceso a esos datos, entonces pues hay personas que generan su negocio en base a eso, ¿no? Tienen un control de estos datos y también además normalmente te fuerzan a un spread que se llama, que es una separación entre el precio de oferta y de demanda, y entonces sacan el beneficio de ahí, ¿no? Te dicen, yo te doy estos datos en tiempo real, a cambio tú operas en mi plataforma, es decir, cuando tú haces una operación, hemos visto que las operaciones iban de vuelta al broker, ¿no? Entonces los brokers te dan los datos, te los dan bien porque les interesa que tú ganes dinero, porque si no ganas dinero no sigues con ellos. Pero siempre van a ponerte ahí una comisión, ¿no? Que puede ser en base a ese spread o también puede ser en base al número de operaciones, eso depende del broker. Pero sí, son empresas de terceros. ¿Sí? Claro, ¿vamos a liberar la aplicación gráfica? Pues esa es una buena pregunta. Y ahora mismo todavía está por definir el modelo de negocio de esta herramienta. Entonces, lo que sí te puedo decir es que por ahora hemos liberado la parte más básica de la arquitectura, que es OS Brain, que podría ser utilizada como sistema multiagente de propósito general. Es decir, ahí no está implementado tampoco ninguna de la funcionalidad del sistema de inversión automática en tiempo real. Pero, bueno, lo que va a pasar en el futuro no lo sé ahora mismo. Claro. Claro. Sí, sí, efectivamente, ¿no? Hay muchas empresas que ofrecen versiones gratuitas de software que, claro, es privativo y que no puedes ejecutar en Linux y que no puedes hacer las estrategias en Python y todas esas inconveniencias, ¿no?, que he puesto antes, pero efectivamente, claro, entonces competir contra eso, pues bueno, no lo sabemos, todavía está por ver ese modelo de negocio, ¿no?, y cómo plantearlo. Puede ser que la resolución sea liberarlo todo. Ahora mismo no lo sé. Pero bueno, en definitiva, esta presentación pretendía simplemente mostrar que es posible hacerlo con Python y con pocos recursos. O sea que, ¿sí?
Comentabas que tanto el trader como el feeder son dependientes del broker.
Tanto el trader como el feeder, sí.
¿En este caso sería para OS Market o hay otra implementación para otros brokers?
Claro, la pregunta es... Bueno, ¿me puedes repetir?
Sí. ¿En los módulos que son dependientes del broker,
sí,
¿esos están ya implementados para algún broker?
Vale, los módulos que son dependientes del broker, si están implementados ya para algún broker. Sí, los tenemos implementados para los brokers con los que nosotros trabajamos normalmente, efectivamente. Sí que tienen que ser dependientes, porque al fin y al cabo, cada broker luego en esto es un poco anárquico, ¿no? Y entonces la forma de proporcionarte estos datos es bastante heterogénea, ¿no? Desde la API que te proporcionan hasta muchas veces también el formato con el que te dan los datos en tiempo real. Entonces, al fin y al cabo tienes que poner un cerebrillo, un agente que actúe como de intermediario, ¿no? Que sea capaz de hacer esa traducción. Coge estos datos de una plataforma que te vienen en cualquier formato y lo traduce, lo pone en un formato que podamos manejar dentro de nuestra plataforma, y por eso lo envía a router, y desde router, que ya sí que sería el primer distribuidor de datos independiente, pues sí que manejamos ya siempre las mismas estructuras de datos. Sí, claro, 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 sí. Vamos, de hecho, nosotros lo que hacemos es para cada broker con el cual queremos interactuar, cogemos una clase base que hay, que sí que tiene pues, las cosas más comunes implementadas, y después pues hay que ajustarla un poquito según las peculiaridades de cada uno de los proveedores. ¿Más preguntas? A mí me encantan las preguntas. Bueno, pues nada, muchas gracias.